everybody. Welcome to Constitution Hall Pass. I'm Mark Harris at the National Constitution Center in Philadelphia. Today, we're going to be looking at the first big change after the signing of the Constitution and the first addition onto that document, the Bill of Rights. Those first 10 amendments, which we sometimes take for granted, guarantee so many of our basic personal freedoms. We're going to be looking at why those freedoms weren't included in the Constitution at first, as well as how they got added in. We'll look at a time when the Bill of Rights didn't play as big of a role in people's lives, until there were some really big changes in America. And we'll look at ways that students, just like you, use the Bill of Rights every single day. Now, we're going to spend some time here at the Constitution Center, but we'll also be visiting some other locations in Philadelphia where the Bill of Rights really comes to life. For our first stop, we're going to spend some time talking about our friends here in Signers Hall. So on September 17th, 1787, the Constitution had just been signed and was about to be printed for the first time. The public got to see the Constitution for the first time in a newspaper called the Pennsylvania Packet. We have a copy of it here at the Constitution Center. But not everybody was as excited about the new Constitution as those signers were. These three statues represent the dissenters. They're the men who saw the final version of the Constitution and still decided not to sign it. We have George Mason, Edmund Randolph, and Elbridge Gerry. They thought that too much power was being taken away from the state governments, that the national government had aristocratic tendencies, and mostly that there was no list of basic rights that protected what citizens had. Now, that last idea really took traction, and a lot of those ideas ended up going into the Bill of Rights. After the Constitution was signed, it didn't officially become a part of law. It still had to be approved by at least 3/4 of the states. We call that process ratification. Now, at these state ratifying conventions, a lot of the states and people were suggesting lists of changes called amendments, which were designed to protect the states and the citizens. So what kind of changes were these state conventions proposing? Well, a lot of them had to do with modifying the structure of the national government, but quite a few of them also wanted to see a list of citizens' rights added to the document, like the declarations of rights that a lot of states had in their own constitutions. That sounds like a good idea, right? Making sure citizens know what kind of rights they have? Well, the people who supported the Constitution, like James Madison here, knew that if that list of rights was included, it would go a long way towards securing the document's approval. Now, Madison went around during the state ratifying conventions, promising to propose a list of amendments that would list and explain the rights citizens had, and he kept his word. He took the best suggestions from the state ratifying conventions, 210 in all, and proposed them to the House as amendments. Of these suggestions, 17 were approved by the House. It then went to the Senate, who threw some of them out and condensed some of the others together to come up with a list of 12. A joint committee of representatives and senators ironed out the last few differences, and on September 24, 1789, 12 of those amendments were approved by the House and taken by the Senate a day later. But the process was only half done. We're standing here in the Senate chamber of Congress Hall in Philadelphia, where the U.S. Senate met for 10 years. Remember, Washington, D.C. doesn't become the nation's capital until the year 1800, so the government has to meet in a few different places, including Philadelphia. Now, it was in this room that the Senate was meeting when the Bill of Rights was ratified by the states in 1791. One floor down from us is where the House of Representatives met. Before amendments to the Constitution go into effect, they have to be approved by 3/4 of the states. Now, what's interesting about the approval of the Bill of Rights is that not all 12 of the amendments approved by Congress made the cut. Only 10 did. The ones that got left out had to do with determining how many Congress people each state gets to have and making sure that members of Congress can't give themselves pay raises until the next election takes place. What's funny about that last one is that none of these amendments had expiration dates, so they were all sort of still floating around until 1992, when the pay raise amendment was ratified by Michigan and it went into effect as the 27th Amendment to the Constitution. So you see, good ideas can stay relevant and stick around for a really long time, over 200 years in this case. So what do we actually get from the Bill of Rights? Like we said earlier, there are 10 amendments in the Bill of Rights. We're standing in DeVos Hall, the permanent exhibition space at the National Constitution Center, a perfect place to talk about what the Bill of Rights actually says. The First Amendment guarantees our freedom of belief, the freedom of speech, press, religion, assembly, and the freedom to petition our government. This allows us to be who we are and say what we think, and citizens use it every single day to change the kind of country that we live in. The Second Amendment guarantees the right of citizens to bear arms. We can keep weapons in our own homes to protect ourselves and our property. Now, for a long time, it had been debated whether or not that was only referring to a militia, like the National Guard. But the Supreme Court recently determined that the Second Amendment gives everyday individual citizens the right to keep guns in their own homes. The Third Amendment guarantees that citizens can't be forced to keep soldiers in their own homes. Now, this doesn't sound like a really likely scenario today, but it's something that the British Redcoats were doing at the time of the American Revolution, and it really caused a lot of problems in people's communities. The Fourth Amendment protects us against unreasonable searches and seizures. This means that police investigating a crime have to follow certain rules when they are searching for evidence so that they don't violate our reasonable expectation of privacy. The Fifth Amendment guarantees us quite a few rights, but they all center around the idea of due process, and most of them have to do with what happens if we're charged with a crime. For example, if a citizen is charged with a crime, the case has to be approved by a grand jury of their fellow citizens, and we can't be forced to testify against ourselves in our own cases. We're also protected against something called double jeopardy. That means we're not allowed to be put on trial for the same crime twice. The Fifth Amendment also limits the government's power of eminent domain, where in some situations the government is allowed to take private property for public use. The Sixth Amendment also guarantees us quite a few rights, and they have to do with what happens when we're accused of a crime. People who are accused of crimes have the right to a speedy trial, so it's heard quickly, by a jury of their peers, everyday citizens, rather than a judge. This way, the citizens get to determine the meaning of the law. And in doing that, we act as a check on the power of government. We also have the right to be informed of charges against us, so we can better prepare our own defenses, and to be represented by an attorney, somebody who's trained in the law that can argue our case for us. The Seventh Amendment deals with civil cases. Now, in civil cases, no one's being charged with a crime or breaking a law, but two parties are having a dispute over personal injuries or an agreement they've made. Think about a lawsuit over damages or a broken contract. The Seventh Amendment says that even these civil cases should be heard by juries of our peers. Again, everyday citizens determining the meaning of the law. The Eighth Amendment protects us against cruel and unusual punishment. This means that when people are convicted of crimes, the punishment that they're given has to be reasonable and make sense with what they were convicted of doing. For example, you wouldn't put somebody in jail for the rest of their lives because of an unpaid parking ticket, right? The Eighth Amendment guarantees that the punishment has to fit the crime. The Ninth Amendment says that just because a freedom isn't included in the Bill of Rights doesn't mean that citizens don't have it. When the idea of a Bill of Rights was being debated, a lot of people were concerned that if the government gave a list of rights, that list would be final, and no other rights could be guaranteed to the people. The Ninth Amendment says that just because a right is not listed doesn't mean that the people don't have that right. And the Tenth Amendment guarantees that any power not given to the federal government belongs to the states or to the people themselves. A lot of the anti-federalists, who were opposed to the new Constitution, were afraid that the newly empowered national government would trample all over the rights of the states to make their own laws that best suited their citizens. The Tenth Amendment was added in so that the states could feel secure in their own powers. So today, people talk a lot about the Bill of Rights. There's something that we look at as the basic protection of our freedoms. But it wasn't always this way. For the first part of American history, the state governments played a much bigger role in people's everyday lives than the federal government did. As a result, people were looking more towards their states to protect their individual freedoms. In addition, before the Civil War, the protections in the Federal Bill of Rights didn't apply to the states. All of this started to change with the ratification of the 14th Amendment in 1868. Gradually, the Supreme Court began to apply more of the provisions to the Bill of Rights to more state laws. The bench I'm standing behind represents the Supreme Court of the United States in Washington, D.C. It's the highest court in the land, and it's where the meaning of the Constitution is hammered out. One of the early interesting examples of the Supreme Court applying the Bill of Rights to state laws is the case of Gitlow v. New York. This was argued in 1925, the time period after World War I, when the federal government passed several laws restricting people's rights to speak their minds or support socialism or communism. In this case, Benjamin Gitlow, a radical socialist, had published a paper called the Left Wing Manifesto, which talked about the need for a revolutionary socialism which used the power of the proletariat to engage in class struggle to build a socialist America. He was convicted under a New York law which made it a felony to advocate overthrowing the government by force. He appealed his case to the Supreme Court, saying that he was only using his First Amendment rights to free speech, and that he didn't directly tell anyone to go out and overthrow the government. Gitlow lost his Supreme Court case, but something very important happened in the process. The Supreme Court determined that the protections of the Bill of Rights could be applied to state laws. Gradually, more and more of those provisions were extended to the states, until today, where the Bill of Rights applies pretty much equally to federal and state laws. This means that everyday citizens, even students just like you, can use the Bill of Rights to stand up for what they believe in and try to make their country a better place. Remember, it's up to all of us to arm ourselves with knowledge of the Constitution and use that Constitution to stand up for what we believe in. Let's take a look at some examples, even right up to very recent past, of students using the Bill of Rights to stand up for their beliefs and impact their school districts and their lives. Think about the Fourth Amendment. That's the one that protects us against unreasonable searches and seizures. Now, when you think about the Fourth Amendment on TV, it's usually some cop drama where the police need a warrant to search a suspected criminal's house. But search and seizure issues and privacy rights also apply in the school districts. Where is the balance between our right to privacy and school districts' responsibility to keep us safe? Well, the Supreme Court determines that on a case-by-case basis. For example, in 2002, in the case Board of Education v. Earls, the Supreme Court said that the Pottawatomie County, Oklahoma school district's drug testing policy was legal. Everyone who wanted to participate in the district's extracurriculars had to submit to random urine tests for drugs. Two students sued the school district, saying that the random tests were too intrusive and that checking for certain drugs didn't have any relevance for activities like academic team or show choir, and were therefore unconstitutional. The court ruled 5-4 that the school was looking out for the best interests of all of its students and allowed the policy to stand. So you might think that the Supreme Court is supporting schools' rights to search and test their students under any circumstances. But it's determined on a case-by-case basis. Just last year, in a case called Safford Unified School District v. Reading, the court ruled 8-1 that a 13-year-old girl's constitutional rights were violated when she was searched for pills at her school in Arizona. When Savannah Redding was accused of carrying some ibuprofen pills, which were banned in the school, administrators searched her backpack and her pockets. When nothing turned up, a school nurse took her to an office where she was told to shake out her bra and her underwear. The court ruled that the school violated her reasonable expectations of privacy, calling the search degrading. These are just two examples of the ways that students like you use the Constitution to define their freedoms. When we arm ourselves with our knowledge of the Constitution and what that Bill of Rights gives us, we get to define the direction that our country moves in. Even though circumstances change over time, we'll always have those 10 amendments to point to and say that we have these rights. Pretty impressive for a list of ideas that's over 200 years old and that not even everybody wanted in the first place. I hope you enjoyed this edition of Constitution Hall Pass. You can learn more about the Bill of Rights and other constitutional topics by visiting our website, constitutioncenter.org, or by adding us as a friend on Facebook. Remember, it's up to all of us to arm ourselves with knowledge of the Constitution and to stand up for what we think is right. From the National Constitution Center in Philadelphia, I'm Mark Karras. We'll see you next time on Constitution Hall Pass.